The fast of the 10th of Tevet, which this year falls on December 25th, is one of the most unusual fasts really in the Jewish calendar. It commemorates many very sad things that happened in Jewish history, perhaps the most significant of which, however, that marked the beginning of the fall of Jerusalem. That is the first fall of Jerusalem resulting in the Babylonian captivity. Over the next few minutes, what I'd like to do is just think a little bit about what that exile and the subsequent exile really meant within the context of Jewish history. And then I'd like to bring it forward to the 20th century to just reflect for a few minutes on, you know, how that affects the Jewish world today. Judaism regards Jerusalem as the navel of the world. This is actually a phrase that occurs in rabbinic literature. And this is something that they have in common in particular with Christian culture. Here's an amazing map. This is the famous cloverleaf map of Heinrich Bunting. And he represents here the world in a very fanciful kind of way, like a cloverleaf, at the center of which, of course, is Jerusalem. You look a little more closely at it, you can see that England is kind of stuck off the edge here, and then you've got even America, the Neue Welt, right, the New World, with some sea monsters threatening boats and things like that. And over here, some looks like a merman, perhaps, or maybe it's a mermaid, hard to tell from this position. And then, of course, right at the center, representing the axis of Europe, Asia, and Africa, and in many ways reflecting the fact that at the edge of the Eastern Mediterranean, Israel really was, and Jerusalem in particular, was the city through which one had to pass if one was traveling by land between those three continents. Looking at it in closer detail, you can see that the three crosses standing outside of Jerusalem clearly indicates Bunting's Christian orientation to this, but in Jewish culture, the sentiment is the same. Jerusalem is the navel of the world. It is at this time, though, on the fast of the 10th of Tevet, that we mark the first attack on the walled city by Nebuchadnezzar, shown here in this 17th century depiction. But it marks a turning point in Jewish history because it refers to a point when Jews were forcibly expelled from their land. And it's marked with a verse in the book of Kings, 2 Kings, chapter 25, that reads, "And in the ninth year of his reign, on the 10th day of the 10th month, Nebuchadnezzar moved against Jerusalem with his whole army. He besieged it, and they built towers against it all around." Through the Talmudic tradition, we have the fast day that is marked on the 10th of Tevet, marking this particular historical event. There are a few archaeological reminders of it, such as this ancient arrowhead discovered in the region, but this definitely left a tremendous scar on the Jewish psyche. The massive exodus of Jews from Jerusalem, shown here in James Tissot's famous rendition, took them all the way out to the region of Mesopotamia. You can see in this map, traveling north and then curving around the region of Syria, following the Euphrates rivers down south into the heartland of Babylonia, where ultimately they would establish communities and ultimately the Talmud would be written in Babylonia. But at the time, it was an incredibly difficult exile and very painful for the Jews. It's very well expressed in this remarkable piece of art by Eduard Bedemann, who was a German Jewish artist from the 19th century. And you can see in the outsides of the frame is a quotation from Psalm 137, "By the rivers of Babylon, there we sat down and we wept when we remembered Zion." And you can see in the image towards the left-hand side, there's the mysterious-looking kind of ziggurat-like architecture, the foreign, strange architecture of Babylon by the Euphrates River. And the pater familias here is comforting, looks like his youngest daughter there, while he is chained and he is holding his lyre because, of course, the forces of Nebuchadnezzar forced the Jews to sing songs of Zion. And this really is a very beautiful expression of the sadness which Jews marked on the 10th of Tevet, and then, of course, on Tisha B'Av, which was an even greater destruction. Fortunately, the Jews were able to return to Israel shortly thereafter. Under King Cyrus, there was a general liberty proclaimed to all of the territories that the Persians conquered, and they dedicated levels of religious freedom that harkened back to the pre-exile era. This particular item, which looks like a corn in the cob, but it's just a way of promulgating official documents. You can see it's incised with a cuneiform stick onto the actual clay. This proclaimed the ability of many of the peoples in the Persian Empire to return to their ancestral worship. In the case of the Jews, this was extremely welcomed because they were able to return to Jerusalem, shown here in the Persian region of Yehud, which was the named region, what would later be called Judea, and they were able to reestablish the temple for several hundred years. In the first century of the Common Era, however, the temple was destroyed yet again, this time by the Romans, and in many ways a much more fearsome destruction than that of Nebuchadnezzar, and a much more long-lasting exile as well. Here you can see a schematic map of the city of Jerusalem. You can see by the topographic lines how the city is built on the top of a hill. There are hills all around this region, right in the middle of the Judean mountain range. And the rebels were holed up inside the city, somewhere around 20,000 rebels, who unfortunately engaged in very heavy infighting and fought with each other so bitterly that they even destroyed each other's siege foodstuffs, the stores that they had set aside to protect themselves against a long siege, which of course was absolutely suicidal. In some cases, the rebels were actually literally suicidal, such as in the fortress of Masada to the south of Jerusalem, which held out for several years until the Romans finally broke through its defenses, and 960 men, women, and children who were living at that mountaintop decided to commit suicide rather than turn themselves over to Roman captivity. But looking at the city here, you can see that four Roman legions under the son of Emperor Vespasian, one Titus, came from the north. They had some skirmishes with some rebels outside of the northern gates, but then they decided to swing around and breach the outer wall at its eastern point, and then they swarmed into the new city proper. They then attacked the inner wall, because there were several walls that protected the old city. By the way, the Temple Mount is the structure that's on the center right there, the sort of rectangular center. And after a week of fighting, they actually breached it and got into the old city per se. They were not, however, able to attack the Temple Mount because the rebels had holed up there and were able to defend themselves against the Roman attack at the Antonia Fortress, which is shown at the northwest corner of the temple. So what Titus decided to do was he built this massive siege wall that surrounded the entire city, taking advantage of the local topography, and essentially starved the rebels for the next 2 weeks. Then in late July, he renewed his attack at the same spot, the northwest corner of the temple, and he was able to swarm in, and ultimately the temple itself was set ablaze on the ninth day of the month of Av, which occurs in the late summer, and is to this day commemorated as a fast day for Jews, where they sit on the floor and read the Book of Lamentations in public, and it's an incredibly sad day for Jews for the last two millennia. After destroying the last holdout of the rebels on the mountaintop of Masada in the forbidding Judean desert, the Romans imposed tremendous sanctions on the Jewish population, shipping away tens of thousands of captives to be slaves in Rome, imposing new and onerous taxes, and many other symbolic humiliations. The Romans also chose to propagandize their victory as much as possible by, for example, creating a whole series of these coins, the Judaea Capta coins, which means Judea has been taken captive. It's kind of a strange thing to say because Judea was already under Roman control from the year 63 before the Common Era. That is, for over a century, it had been Roman territory. It was really putting down a rebellion more than it was, you know, capturing a new territory. But nevertheless, the resilience of the rebels and the fact that they held off the Romans for so long meant that they wanted to take good advantage of their victory, and there were also internal political reasons why it made sense to do so in Rome as well. On the left, you see the Emperor Vespasian. On the right, you see a Roman soldier standing and looking down at a forlorn Jewish woman, and in between them is the balsam pine, which was one of the most popular exports of Judea at the time. They also built a ceremonial arch in Rome itself that was the site of a major parade celebrating the victory and ultimately executing some prisoners of war. Many Jews for hundreds of years refused to walk under this arch because there is a representation on the inside of the stealing of the spoils from the temple. This is what it looks like today. Scholars at Yeshiva University have reconstructed what it might have looked like to Romans because they preferred to paint their statues. And so this is, you see the Romans all wearing the wreath of victory over their heads, and on the signs on the left says Leges Judaeorum, the law of the Jews, perhaps a sacred Torah or maybe even the tablets of the law. The second one in the middle says Candelaborum Judaeorum, the Jewish menorah, and on the right the Sacra Judaeorum, the holy thing of the Jews, with probably the Shulchan, the ritual table there with the staves. And this is how it was commemorated in Rome. Nevertheless, Jews always regarded Jerusalem as their center, even when it was in destruction over 2,000 years. Now, Jews historically were not great map makers. We don't have a lot of Jewish maps, but this other Christian map, which is located in Jordan, it was actually discovered under the floor of a 6th century church there, and it was meant to guide pilgrims to the land of Israel. And what's interesting about this map, which is called the Madaba map, it's quite highly damaged, as you can see, and that's as a result of the construction that went on over the centuries, but also because of the iconoclastic efforts of some of the Muslim conquerors who chose to remove any images of human beings. The map is kind of interesting because it's oriented not towards the north, like our contemporary maps today, but towards the east. That is, the top of the map is east, as if you were standing at the bottom, at the edge of the Mediterranean Sea, looking forward. And in fact, one of the words for east in Hebrew is kedem, which means forward as well. And you can see here, Jerusalem is identified as in the center, just like we saw in the Bunting map earlier. And look at it in greater detail. This is actually a fairly accurate representation of what we believe Jerusalem must have looked like in the 6th century. In fact, there are certain features of this map which were only identified with archaeological research in the 20th century. So it's a fascinating early map, a mosaic of Jerusalem. But on the 10th of Tevet, it's not only a time for reflection on the sadness of the destruction of Jerusalem and on its exile, but it's also a moment to look forward to the ultimate redemption. And that's especially so, I think, in this year, which is an unusual year because the 10th of Tevet actually falls on a Friday. Typically, fast days that fall on Fridays are not fully observed. They're pushed off to other days because it's not considered appropriate to go into the Sabbath, which begins Friday night, in a state of extreme hunger. But this particular fast requires fasting right up until the Sabbath begins. And I think it's especially important, therefore, to note that just like the Sabbath represents a redemption from the tribulations of the week, so too the times that we're experiencing with Israel in the 20th and 21st century give a hint to an ultimate redemption as well. Let's have a quick look at some 20th century developments in Israel. So this is a map of a partition plan that was designed by the United Nations, actually the League of Nations, in 1947. And it was an attempt to deal with the ongoing stresses between the Arab population and the Jewish population in the region. And the decision was to divide up the area into seven distinct, barely connected units. You can see here the orange units, kind of yellow color, were to be set aside for Arabs. And that basically more or less conformed to the demographic distribution of Arabs. And then the sort of greenish aqua color was supposed to be a Jewish state, the first Jewish state to be established in the region since the Roman Empire took it over in the first century. I mean, it's an amazing achievement and really mind-boggling in many ways. So that's another three sections. Jerusalem, shown here, if we zoom in, was such a difficult problem to solve then and now, that the United Nations suggested it should just be designated an international zone. As the history developed, the Jews in the region accepted this plan. The Arabs in the surrounding countries did not, and you had the first of several Arab-Jewish wars, which ultimately resulted in a slight hardening of the boundaries for Israel, surprisingly so, because they were surrounded by Arab countries all around. And this is what the armistice lines looked like between 1949 until another major war in 1967. You can see that the blue area is now held by the Jewish state of Israel. Gaza is held by Egypt, and the West Bank is held by Jordan. When you zoom into Jerusalem itself, you can see that it is actually divided, because the front lines fell in such a way that most of the city, the newer part of the city, was behind the Israeli lines. That's in the kind of green, sort of a yellow color. And the old city with the Temple Mount and the more heavily Arabic population fell in the Jordanian side of the boundary. So Jerusalem was actually divided, with the Jewish quarter and the old city on the Arab side of the border. Everything changed, of course, with the massive victory of 1967, which was really one of the most stunning victories of the 20th century, when Israel, anticipating a major attack from Egypt and Syria in particular, launched a preemptive strike, and within 6 days had not only consolidated their territory, but it also expanded it significantly, with the mountain range of the Golan in the north, the entire west bank of the Jordan River, the Gaza Strip, and the Sinai Peninsula all became part of Israeli territory. Now, the consequences of these territorial acquisitions were quite significant. Ultimately, the Sinai Peninsula would be returned to Egypt in exchange for a peace treaty that occurred in the late 70s and early 80s. Gaza was ultimately simply abandoned in the early 2000s. And the West Bank was associated with the Palestinian autonomy developed in the 1990s. Jerusalem remained a very difficult problem to solve in the context of the local politics, but what is extremely significant for our point of view is the fact that with this war, Jerusalem was once again united under Israeli control. On the left here, you see the very iconic photograph of the time when Jewish soldiers approached the Western Wall, the remains of the temple, for the first time since it had been sealed off by the Jordanian forces. In many ways, this moment represented a culmination of Jewish aspirations for Jerusalem that went back 2,000 years at least to the Roman expulsion. The photograph on the right is the reconstruction of that image, with the same soldiers now looking just a little bit more mature. This has been a very brief presentation, but I want to remind you that tomorrow morning there will be a couple other talks by Rabbi Shai Schachter and by Rabbi Yaakov Trump on the concept of redemption, tying to this history that we've described here tonight and many other things. I hope you'll find those talks very useful, and I want to wish you an easy fast and a speedy redemption. Thank you very much for listening.